Thank you all so much for joining us today.
Let's see if this works.
My name is Daniel Lewkow, and I'm the political director for Common Cause Oregon. Thank you so much for joining us for the Dirty Energy and Dirty Money forums. I'm going to go over the agenda real quickly, and then we'll start the presentation. I will follow it up with a panel discussion. If you have any questions, we ask that you hold them till the end, because we have a question-answer period. But what we did was, in late 2015, we pulled together a team of research interns to look at the simple question of, how does big oil impact Oregon's democracy? How did big oil and their allies in the fossil fuel industry and the transportation industry, how do they use their money and their influence to impact our democracy here in Oregon? So we dove into some, we did a deep dive into some research, and we looked through public records, we looked through disclosure reports, we did on-the-ground interviews with people who knew the environmental community and lobbied in the legislature, and pulled together the report that's the basis for this information. And then we partnered with a lot of great organizations here today. Of course, Oregon Environmental Council, League of Women Voters, OLCV, Oregon Wild, 350, Beyond Toxics, and a lot of other incredible organizations here too. So I'd like to begin by doing a brief 15-minute presentation of what our findings are. And then after the presentation's done, we'll jump right to a panel discussion, and that's when we'll open the floor to they gave some money also to House Majority Leader Val Hoyle and House Speaker Tina Kotek. Again, we don't have campaign contributions, so anyone can accept a $42,000 contribution from a group of businesses. That's absolutely legal in Oregon, but it's not legal in most other states. Associate Oregon Loggers, same thing. $15,000 to the lead Republican in the Senate, Ted Ferrioli. $12,000 to the lead Republican in the House, Mike McClain. Oregon Farm Bureau, also working against the clean fuels legislation. This represents the agricultural industry. And we had kind of donations both to the legislators themselves and to the PAC funds for their parties. So what happens when you have an election coming up every 2 years is that the Republican or Democratic caucus has a political action committee. And the legislators raise money for the political action committee, and then they pay the political action, they give money over to the PAC, and the PAC is the one that makes sure candidates from their party win in the upcoming November elections. So if you see a donation to the Senate Republicans PAC, like the $8,700 that came from the Oregon Farm Bureau, it's likely that one of the Senate Republicans was fully aware of that donation too. Associate General Contractors represents contractors and folks who work in the construction industry, very powerful group, and worked against the clean fuels bill. Again, they kind of give across the political aisle $6,000 to Democrat Peter Courtney, Senate President, $6,000 to the House Minority Leader Mike McClain, who's a Republican. So they give a huge contribution too. The other thing that's really important about this is that these groups all interact with each other quite a bit. So the Associate General Contractors President is Mike Salzgiver. He is also on the Board of Directors for Associated Oregon Industries. That's the group that gave that $42,000 contribution that we talked about. And he was a previous Vice President for the Portland Business Alliance. So oftentimes, they can kind of use their own personal networking to try to make sure other associations and businesses support the same policies they do. How much in total did all the legislators receive from clean energy opponents? One caveat here before I answer that is that what we looked at is legislative leadership. And those were the six legislators I mentioned before. So the Senate President, Senate Majority Leader, Senate Minority Leader, House Speaker, House Majority Leader, House Minority Leader. These are often considered the most influential legislators. And so they receive the bulk of the campaign contributions. So when we say how much did legislative leaders take from clean energy opponents, that's who we're referring to. In total, they took around over $250,000 from opponents of clean fuels. Representative Mike McClain, who's a Republican leader in the House, took almost half of that himself, $120,000 from opponents of environmental legislation. So again, these big contributions happen because we don't limit campaign donations in Oregon. And which leaders took what money is what we're actually looking at here too. Again, this is all going to be online for you to review after the forms are finished on June 29th. But as we talked about, the Oregon Refuse and Recycling Association, also against clean fuels, gave $13,000 to Representative Mike McClain. Roseburg Forest Product Company gave $2,500 to our Representative Al Hoyle, who was the majority leader in the House at the time. So these are the specific donations that opponents of environmental legislation made to legislative leaders. And other influential legislators too. Of course, they give to legislators, whether they're new to legislature, whether they've been there a long time. The special interests we're talking about give across the aisle, Democrats and Republicans. And these were other legislators that these businesses and business groups felt were influential. So Senator Betsy Johnson, Democrat from Astoria, Cliff Benz, Republican from Eastern Oregon, all taking money from the opponents of environmental legislation. And that's kind of a breakdown specifically of how much they took. Senator Johnson took $15,000, including one $5,000 donation from the Oregon Forest Industries Council PAC. That's the PAC that represents the timber industry in Oregon. The Ore Loggers PAC, which also works very closely with the timber industry, gave $23,000 to these other influential legislators. So what's also important is that these special interests don't just give directly to the candidates. They also pass their donations through shell organizations. And that's how they get around disclosure reports. Because in Oregon, if you make a campaign contribution to a ballot committee or a legislator or someone running for governor or actually any office, it's reported online. It's on the Secretary of State's website and it's free for all to see. I encourage you to check out ORSTAR. It's a really great resource. But the loophole in the law is that it only reports the last donation made. So if, for instance, Monsanto gives a donation to a legislator, that shows up in ORSTAR and is available for the public. But how they get around that is they pass their donations through. You have to go and track the donations, and it takes a very long time to do that. So this is a good example of a group called the First Vote PAC and then the Oregon Farm Bureau. The chemical and timber companies like Monsanto, DuPont, Seneca Timber, they gave money to First Vote PAC. They gave actually over $20,000 between April and August 2015. First Vote PAC then turned around and gave money to the Oregon Farm Bureau. And the Oregon Farm Bureau then turned around and gave $96,730 to candidates running for legislature in 2014 and 2016. So in the disclosure reports, it only shows up as the Oregon Farm Bureau giving to the candidates, when actually the donation began with Monsanto and they passed it through shell organizations. So another, we have good transparency laws in Oregon, so we got some major loopholes we gotta close. And you can see here, the First Vote PAC gave to all kind of candidates, Republicans and Democrats, senators and representatives. They also paid for secret attack ads too. And what they did was they sent negative mail pieces to the districts of legislators where they thought the legislator was on the fence about whether or not to vote for the clean fuels bill, or that the legislator was in a swing district and could be kind of scared out of voting for the clean fuels bill. These are some examples. Representative Shamir Fagan, who is out of Happy Valley in the Portland metro area, received a really nasty mail piece tying her to the Kiss Halper resignation scandal in January and February of 2015. Representative David Gomberg, a Democrat on the coast of Oregon, also got hit with a really nasty mail piece too. And then Senator Betsy Johnson, who voted against the Clean Fuels Bill, got a really nice thank you mail piece sent to her district. What's important about this is that we don't really know who paid for these mail pieces. We know that the Oregon Capital Watch Foundation ultimately sent the mail pieces out. But we don't, because of their tax classification, we don't know if anyone gave them money to do that. So did the oil industry or the timber industry or any other group or any other candidate give the Oregon Capital Watch Foundation money to send out the mail pieces? We'll never know because of our loophole and our disclosure law around tax classifications. Also in Oregon, it's not illegal, or I guess let me put it this way. Oregon's one of only four states to not require paid-for-by statements on political ads. So anywhere in the country, except for four states, which is Oregon, Arkansas, Georgia, and Mississippi, anywhere else in the entire country is, and even on a federal race, like Hillary Clinton for president, Donald Trump for president, almost everywhere else in the country, when a campaign sends out a TAC ad or when it pays for any kind of ad or any kind of, I guess merchandise for people to take, they have to say who paid for it on the ad. Oregon's one of the only states that doesn't do that. So it's totally legal in Oregon to send out mysterious attack ads. And because of a, I would argue, outdated legal opinion from 1999, it is believed that the Oregon court would strike that down if we did put that in place, although there's definitely mixed legal opinion. Oh, and then one more thing about the Oregon Capital Watch Foundation. Its executive director is a guy named Jeff Crope, who was a former state representative and the former chapter president of the Americans for Prosperity, which is a Koch brothers organization in Oregon. So Jeff Crope, who now is in charge of the Oregon Capital Watch Foundation, was in charge of the Koch brothers organization in Oregon too. The other thing that a lot of these groups did is they hired lobbyists, and they hired lots and lots of lobbyists too, to work to kill the legislation while it was in session. So the top 10 opposition groups paid $2.2 million to hire over 22 lobbyists in to fight the Clean Fuels Bill in the legislature. Even though 70% of Oregonians supported this bill, their interests were outspent 10 to 1 by corporations and special interests working to kill. In some of the biggest lobbyist groups, Associate General Contractors, Western States Petroleum Association, Oregon Trucking Association, and you can see here kind of a bigger breakdown of how much they paid. Associate General Contractors paid $580,000 for a series of lobbyists to go and fight bills that they think were against their industry in the legislative session. Oregon Refuse and Recycling Association, Chevron USA Incorporated, Associated Oregon Industries, all paid big bucks to make sure that lobbyists are going to kill the bills that they thought were problematic for their industry. And who worked for Big Oil? And who were these lobbyists? Well, you got the Oregon Fuels Association. They made the campaign contributions to legislators, and they hired lobbyists, Danielle Romain and Paul Romain. You had the Western States Petroleum Association. They do not make campaign contributions, but they still hire lobbyists. They hired Brian Doherty and Christina Squires, and then British Petroleum, BP, also hired Brian Doherty, but hired Kelsey Wilson and Greg Peen as well. These were the lobbyists working for the oil industry in Oregon. And then their allies too, again, 22 lobbyists working to make sure the Clean Fuels Bill was defeated in the legislative session. You had Associated Oregon Industries, Associated General Contractors, Oregon Farm Bureau, that's the agricultural industry, and the Associated Oregon Loggers. What's really important about lobbying in Oregon is that we are one of the states that don't have a special disclosure law. So in Idaho, lobbyists have to disclose what bills they're trying to influence. So you can, it's public, you can go and see who are the special interests who are trying to defeat this bill or trying to promote this bill or trying to pass this rule. Idaho has that law, Oregon does not. So we, this is who we know was trying to defeat the Clean Fuels Bill based on their testimony and based on our interviews with on-the-ground folks, but there might have been other organizations we don't know because we don't have that very simple direct disclosure law. So after all this money, after all this influence, what happened to the Clean Fuels Bill? Well, SB 324 passed out of the Senate on February 17th by a 17-13 vote, near party line, and after a record five-hour debate, it passed in the House by a 31-29 vote, again, almost along party lines. Governor Brown signed the law soon after. But what also happened was that clean fuel opponents were able to use their influence to sell to the public that the transportation bill couldn't pass as well. So the transportation bill is a $343 million funding project to update and rebuild our roads, our bridges, and our other crucial transportation networks. It was supported by businesses, it was supported by labor unions, it was widely understood as very strongly needed in Oregon. And the special interests who are fighting the Clean Fuels Bill went to the public and said, unless you repeal the Clean Fuels Bill, the transportation bill, we're not going to let it pass in Oregon. So they, at least in terms of what the perception was they were selling to the voters, they held the bill hostage. And by the way, they couldn't pass it without Republican support in the legislature, because in Oregon, you need three-fifths of legislators to vote for a tax increase. In a lot of states, sometimes it's simple majority. Some states have super majority laws too. Even though Democrats had a majority in the legislature, they didn't have the majority required to pass a transportation package because it was funded by a gas tax. So they had to get one Republican to vote with them to pass the bill. And Republicans absolutely locked down and said they were not going to vote for the transportation bill. And thus, we got to a point where the transportation bill did not move through. It's a complicated process, but one thing that's really important to remember is special interest had a lot of influence over the transportation bill, which is widely understood to be very needed in Oregon. Governor Brown brought together four Democrats and four Republicans into a gang of eight to negotiate a solution. The gang of eight recommended repealing the Clean Fuels Program in the same session that passed it, and then passing the transportation package. But the plan went to a special Senate committee, but died because it did not have enough support. So in the end, Big Oil lost, which is really crucial to remember. And they lost because everyday voters came together and said that they wanted an environmental bill to move through the legislature. So we hear a lot about big money overwhelming the voices of the voters. It's very problematic, and it really has a lot of negative effects, as we've seen here. But when voters come together, they can overcome big money. I think what's important is that Big Oil was instrumental in blocking the desperately needed transportation bill. That's what we discussed. They almost repealed a popular bill to fight climate change in the same legislative session, and they'll continue to have so much power until we pass important reforms to our democracy. And that brings the question, how do we rebalance our democracy in Oregon? We talk a lot about the federal level, and I'll mention that in a second. But Oregon, we can pass a lot of really good needed changes here too. We could pass contribution limits. We are, again, one of only 44 states that does not limit contributions to candidates. But if we were able to do so, we can make sure that one corporation or special interest cannot buy an entire election. It's a really fundamental bill. It'll also allow us to pass reforms like preventing contractors who contract with the state from donating to campaigns in exchange for special contracts. You know, we can also put contribution limits on judges who run for office, because we elect our judges here. I think we all agree that judges should be impartial. So the ability to have contribution limits in Oregon is a really fundamental reform that we can pass here. We can empower small donors. If we pass reform similar to what they passed in New York City and Seattle, and what they're going to consider on a statewide level in Washington State, we can make sure that candidates can win by raising money from small donors and not from corporate PACs. And that brings more folks into the process and raises everyone's voice when candidates can go to their neighbors and people in their district and people who are affected by these policies and raise money for them and still win. If candidates do not have to go to corporate PACs, that could be a really good reform we can pass here in Oregon. We need to strengthen transparency. As I said, we need to require paid-for-by taglines to stop anonymous smear attacks in Oregon. That's very crucial. And we need to shine a light on pastor donations. That was that first vote pack I showed you that went through the Oregon Farm Bureau. We can pass a lot of reforms that will shine a light on these pastor donations. And then we can reform ethics laws, requiring lobbyists to disclose which bills they are influencing. Again, we have that law in Idaho. We can totally pass in Oregon, but it's something that voters need to be engaged in. And ultimately, the biggest thing we can do is the voters need to lean in. When voters don't pay attention, that's when special interests pass laws that aren't in the public interest. But if voters speak with one clear voice all throughout the process and say they want reforms, we can do it here in Oregon, because we've done it in other states here. And then, the other reform that we need to make, is we need to overturn Citizens United. And this is at a federal level. And obviously, there's two ways to overturn Citizens United. The Supreme Court could reverse this decision. That's a possibility, although it would be a lengthy process, of course. We could also pass an amendment to our federal constitution saying money is not speech and corporations are not people. That's supported by 78% of Americans. And this would allow us to rein in that dark money, rein in that independent spending, and prevent the Koch brothers from trying to buy our democracy. So that's all the information that our research interns compiled into a single report. We, of course, engage with a lot of great stakeholders who work together to make this possible. We sifted through public records reports. We looked through transparency reports, which all of you can do too. And that's how we came up with the core presentation for Dirty Energy and Dirty Money. So, thank you, by the way, so much for joining us for this presentation.